Good evening, everyone. Thank you. Thank you very much for sharing your weekday evenings with us. There are different reasons why we're always worried about some date or the other, but I must say you make us feel extremely welcome, and it's wonderful to be back here post-Diwali on a weekday to see all of you here in such large numbers. As I joked the first time that we came to Bangalore, you make us feel like a vote, you've given us a vote of confidence, and we feel like the single largest party in the country, you know. So thank you. I'll just wait till everyone's taken a seat. It's, as I said, particularly wonderful to be here after Diwali. There's a small story I wanted to share with you that we had Baman Irani with us a few months ago at Algebra, and he's post-60 and he has a mother who's in her 90s. And he said that even now, every time he goes to meet her, when he's leaving the door, she says, "Son, go sparkle." And that pretty much redefines what Diwali should really become for all of us. And it's wonderful to see all of you sparkling here today. So thank you. As you know, there are always five or six of us women who are joining me in welcoming you here. There's Nina, there's Ritu, Payal, who's not here today. Her niece is getting married. There's Anjali and Rimjim and Shuli. All of us join me in welcoming you here today. We're going to have two sessions back on back because it's a weekday. And the first session will immediately be followed by a performance. And then we have dinner because, again, because it's a Diwali season, festive. Since we've just come out of this festive mood, Jain Global Institute, our presenting partners for the evening, have very kindly agreed to host a dinner. So do stay on. And our first speaker will be signing books after both the sessions are over. So please don't leave in between. But when we finish with both sessions, he will be signing books. So before we start the evening, I'd really just like to thank a few people. There is, of course, first the Leela Hotel, who have made us feel very much at home over here. It's not just a venue partner, not just a hospitality partner, but really a collaborator and a co-traveler in this journey. There's Gaurav Chauhan, the manager of Leela. If you're here, thank you very much for your continued partnership. Jain Global Institute, of course, who's our presenting partner for all our events in Bangalore. Thank you for making this possible. I'd really like to thank Rare Rabbit, a new partner who's come on board with us, and I hope you journey long with us across the country. They are committed to the idea of celebrating Indian luxury. They have a cutting-edge line of men's clothes, beautiful concept stores across the country, one right here in Bangalore. And thank you for coming on board. And then, of course, Bengaluru. Oh, you have three, sorry. Three stores here, and I thought you were correcting me for saying Bangalore. At the pace at which we're changing names of our cities, you know, it's going to require computer mind to remember that. And then, of course, we have our continuing partners. There's Phoenix Kesaku and Glenlivet and Pepsi, who keep us all in very liquid good humor at all times. So thank you. And now to start with the first session of the evening, it's a real privilege to have General Zameer Uddin Shah here with us. He was he left as deputy chief of the Indian Army. But before that, he spent an entire lifetime in the army, fighting on every battlefront that was there in India. He was there in the 1971 Bangladesh War. He fought the Punjab insurgency. He's fought insurgencies in the Northeast. He was the general that was brought in to quell the Gujarat riots. And in many other battlefronts, you know, post the parliament attack and Operation Parakram, he's really been in the trenches and knows what it is to live in a conflict zone. But it's not just that that makes it such a privilege to have General Shah here, because it's not just to give insights into the army, but also to be a particular identity within the army, which while he embodies it, he has not worn it on his sleeve, but it's a very important aspect of his experience in the army, which is that General Shah was a Muslim officer in an army that barely has 2.5% representation. And that is true actually of representation in most aspects of India's public life. And so it's a very important identity where he embodies that cultural conversation of what it is to be a Muslim inside a big public institution. And then of course, General Shah, not satisfied with having been in as many battle zones as I just described, picked a particular battle zone, which was to become the Vice Chancellor of Aligarh Muslim University, where he set himself the task to really preserve the ethos of a university that he loves, that his family has long been associated with, and to preserve its ethos of being a progressive liberal institution that will speak really for the future of Muslims in India, but also for a very secular and liberal education. And that's a whole other battle that he fought, which was, I would say, pretty much as high octane as some of the other conflicts that he's been in. He's been awarded many medals, including the highest medal for in the peace times. But as I said, it's a real privilege to have General Shah here because of the forthrightness with which he speaks. He's now written of his journey inside the army in a book called Sarkari Musalman, My Years in the Indian Army. And it's a very intriguing title that I hope he will elaborate on and explain why he wrote a book being called the Sarkari Musalman. So ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming General Shah. So just to give you a taste of the impact General Shah has, we had him at our Gurgaon edition 2 days ago and he got a standing ovation, so you know what you're in for as well today. Thank you for joining us again, General.
Thank you.
So, sir, you know, rather than throw you into the deep end and really ask you about some of the most conflagratory milestones of your career, I'd actually like to start now with a kind of reflective sense of where you were. You were in the army, as I said, through all these years of conflict, but there's a certain takeaway that you had from it, you know? So what were the lessons that being in the army really taught you? Life lessons, character lessons. What was your takeaway from all these years that you spent in the army?
Well, all I would say is that I think the army is the epitome of what the country should be. It is a totally secular organization. It doesn't bother what caste, creed, color you are. It gives you responsibilities. And whenever there's a fire, let it be floods, let it be war, or let it be children being rescued from wells, it is always the weapon of the last resort. And it's always in demand. And I would say that the army has done a creditable job wherever it's been committed. I've got a couple of points about the army. And that is, I don't think it's been given its due for the services it renders to the country. My constant refrain and complaint is that whenever it comes to pay commissions and other considerations, what is talked about is, oh, these fellows have got all the clubs, they play golf, they've got sevadars, and they've got canteens. What they don't talk about is that we spend half of our lifetime away from our families, serving in inhospitable terrain and deserts all over. But that is not talked about. And I have talked a lot about, in my book, The Army Wives. I think they have made a very great contribution in permitting their husbands to serve and not be bothered on the home front. One thing which the country must emulate and which the army has been preaching is that religion is your private matter. I always said that when I was in uniform, the army was my religion. It really didn't matter. And once I did take my brother to Eid function, it was a battalion with Muslim troops. There was a Maulvi, but that battalion also had a company of Sikhs and a company of Dogras and two companies Muslim. And we entered a large hall called the Hall of Worship. Of course, the west portion was given to the Muslims because they have to face westwards when praying. Anyway, the Maulvi got up, gave a little lecture, and the namaz was read. After that, the granthi got up and there was a granth. And then the Maulvi got up, the Panditji got up, all in one hall and gave a talk. All the talks were centered on peace, amity, and how all the great religions of the world see each other. I mean, there's nothing different. And this hall of worship was named MMG, not medium machine gun, but Mandir Masjid Gurdwara. And everybody was praying together, everybody was living together. So I see this as the future of our country. If we can all learn to live together like the army does, don't push religion to extremes, I think ours can be a great country, and it will be. I'm quite sure of it.
So, General Shah, you said about the army not receiving its due, and you know the texture of the army in terms of its non-communal nature. But I was asking you that what were the lessons that you got personally, whether out of leadership, you know, or life lessons? In what ways did it help shape you and give you lessons that you could take away in life in general?
Right. I spent many, many years in insurgency areas. We sorted out the insurgency in Gujarat, and I spent many years in Nagaland, Manipur, Tripura, all these areas. I think the biggest problem confronting the country is the threat within, not external threats. External threats we can take care of. The threats within. And, of course, we've got this problem in JNK and Nagaland still brewing. I am convinced that there is no military solution to an insurgency. We've been trying to fight the Nagas for the last 70 years, 71 years. We still haven't been able to subjugate or conquer their armed tribesmen. This process will only come through peace, through development. We neglected the Northeast. We didn't even build our railway. They are cut off. There are no communications. There are no employment opportunities. So what does the local do? He takes up arms, and it becomes more of a profession and a business. So development is the only answer for our problems. And this is going to happen in Jharkhand also. This, unless we develop the areas, that is number one take. The second thing is a few things which I learned, and that is a thing called battle fatigue. I mean, I have seen massive ambushes being successful in battalions which have finished their tenures and are about to move out. And they've been subjected to real bad ambushes because of the fact that battle fatigue had overtaken caution. And people had become complacent, and so we suffered casualties. Another thing which I learned is that nothing is as good or as bad as initially reported. Whenever, and that is for leaders of this country, whenever something is reported, take your time before believing or unbelieving a story given to you.
So, like you said, there's no better substitute than actually going to the ground and getting a first-hand report, you know, which most media has forgotten to do now, to really get that first-hand report. But sir, let's come to the title of your book. You know, as I said, it's a very unique term to have for what does Sarkari Musalman mean? What did it mean for you? How did this term come about? And what is the great irony of being a Sarkari Musalman? What was your experience of it?
Okay. Actually, my course mates and a few senior contemporaries were very perturbed that I had chosen what they perceived to be a sort of a communal title. But if you read the book, I've explained why I've called it the Sarkari Musalman. A Sarkari Musalman is a sobriquet or a name given by the Muslim community, firstly to people who were born Muslim, but capitalized on Islamophobia and right against Islam. That means they ridicule Islam for lucre, for contracts. I won't be afraid, Salman Rushdie, born Muslim. He wrote this terrible book called The Satanic Verses, which the Ayatollah made the greatest mistake of issuing a fatwa against. And that's the reason why I read it. I said, why did the Ayatollah ban it? Why did he issue a fatwa? And I found it unreadable. Anyway, I went through it. So Salman Rushdie is one. Of course, he's a great author, but he capitalizes on this. The second, closer to home, is Taslima Nasreen. I admire the work she's been doing in for gender equality and everything else. But her star appeal is Islam bashing. I saw a photograph of hers last Ramadan, where she says, Ramadan Mubarak. And she says, enjoying a lovely lunch. Now that is rubbing Muslims who fast. Okay, here is somebody who was born a Muslim ridiculing the month of Ramadan. But my father was called a Sarkari Musalman because he was a government servant and he wanted to ensure that the position he had been posted to Ajmer at the shrine of the Sufi saint, which was under control of the Panda equivalent, they're called Khadims in the Dargahs. They had the control, they were channelizing all the money, but the government got hold of the finances and used it for education and good purposes. So everybody said, Shah Sahab is pushing and government agenda, he's a Sarkari Musalman. When I was Vice Chancellor of Aligarh Muslim University, a lot of Muslim parents, let me tell you, Aligarh Muslim University is a modern secular university. It is not, well, there are certainly more Muslims in the university, and I'll tell you why. But these parents always expected me to do something out of, beyond the rules. And when I didn't, they say, Shah Sahab ke paas jana bekar hai, Sarkari Musalman hai. He doesn't kowtow to the illegitimate demands of his own community. So I was accused of that. But what really made me select the title was when I was a second lieutenant, I was in Mussoorie and I met 10 or 12 of these strapping young lads. They belonged to the Aligarh Muslim University riding team. They had come to participate in the Indian Military Academy horse show. So I said, here's a captive audience. Let's try and convince them to join the armed forces. And I told them the honor and glory of wearing uniform. I also told them that we need horsemen, we need polo players. At the end of my talk to this captive audience, I said, how many of you want to join? Not a single hand was raised, except I got the response, Janab, aap to Sarkari Musalman hai. That means what you are doing, you're talking the government language and you are pushing an agenda. So they didn't believe me. But a word about Aligarh Muslim University. It is a modern secular university. You'll be surprised to know that Times Higher Education London and US News and World Report in the year 2017-18 graded it as the top university of the country. If you don't believe it, I've got the chart in the book. It was graded as the best university of the country. So I was asked, why are they 80% Muslim and 20% non-Muslim? If it is a secular university, you say that admissions are purely on merit, not religious based. Well, I said subjects like Quranic studies, Islamic studies, Urdu, Persian, Farsi, no non-Muslim comes. So that skews the ratio in favor of the Muslims. In courses that matter, medicine, engineering, nanotechnology, there's an equal proportion of both.
So, General Shah, we'll come to the university because, like I said, that's a whole battlefront on its own. But wanted you to dive in a little more into your army experience first. But before that, just to finish that conversation about being a Sarkari Musalman, how did you reconcile for yourself what being a Muslim for you, not just within the army, but in the milieu that you see around you now? How did you want to define yourself as being a Muslim? You know, what about it mattered? What about it didn't matter? And you came out of a madrasa schooling in your childhood. Of course, you went on to other schools after that. But in this whole thing that you've described, you know, about either speaking for the community or being seen as alien, how did you position yourself? How did you understand your own Muslim identity?
I'm very proud to say that I started my education in a madrasa. I went every morning with a takhti and a kalam and a reed pen and sat on the floor of the mosque and learned how to write Arabic calligraphy. But then subsequently, I went to an Irish Christian brother school, St. Joseph's College, Nainital, which really made men out of us. So it was a totally secular institution with a Christian ethos. And that didn't trouble us. Nobody tried to convert us. I learned that. My classmates are here. Two are Parsis, one is a Hindu and one is a Christian. So we are lifelong friends. So the friendship that comes about in childhood is lifelong. And if you poison a young mind, that poison, that venom will remain lifelong. As a Muslim, I was very proud of the fact that I was one, and I tried to follow the tenets of my religion, which are pretty difficult to follow. But I never wore it on my sleeve. As I said, the uniform or the army was my religion. And I didn't bother. I used to, when I was commanding a regiment of Rajputs, 100%, all from Rajasthan, well, I attended the mandir. It didn't bother me. It didn't bother the men when I officiated in a mandir function. Because in the army, we call it mandir parade, where you jolly well go. So it didn't bother me. At 3 p.m., whenever I fasted, they would bring breakfast for me. The men didn't bother. So the secret is, don't wear religion on your sleeve. It is your private matter between you and your maker. It didn't affect me at all. My career, it didn't affect me at all. I was involved in 1971, where when the guns of my battery were punishing a fortress, Islamgarh, into Pakistani Sindh. A junior commissioned officer retrieved the Quran from the mosque and gave it to me. He said, "Sahab, I thought it would be in safe custody." Well, I still have it. And I think whenever things improve, I'll probably go back to Islamgarh and give it back in the mosque where it rightly belongs. So this is the way we treat religion in the army. It's your private business. It didn't bother me. It didn't bother my command. And I'm very, very proud of it.
So we'll come back to some of the battles. But it's interesting that you said that when you went to this Christian missionary school that they made men out of you. I didn't share one aspect of your biography with the audience, which is that you have an illustrious brother, Zameer Uddin Shah, who's one of the country's most celebrated actors. And his memory of school is completely different from yours. You know, he doesn't feel that school made a man out of him. He feels school made, you know, would have made a kuchumbar out of him, actually, if he had given them a chance. And he pretty much had to run away from home and school to become the man that he's become. So what was it like? You know, what was the sibling relationship between you? And why is your memory of school so different? You know, for you, it's the making of you. For him, it was the unmaking of him.
Well, there were three of us studying in boarding. My father had a government job, and he was being posted out every 2 or 3 years. So he felt the safest place was to entrust us to the Irish brothers. And my elder brother was a year elder to me. He was a class senior. He finished his senior Cambridge without any coaching or anything like that. He cracked the IIT and went off to IIT Kharagpur, went off, stayed many years abroad, married an Egyptian. He was brilliant. He used to stand first in class. I was more interested in games. And I stood a very safe 15 out of 30 in class. But Nasir stood at the right at the end, 30 out of 30. Now, the problem in school is he desperately wanted to act. But these 30 out of 30 had to attend extra classes. And they had to, whenever there were movies, they were allowed to sit in the hall, but had to face backwards. This was punishment to them, mortification of the highest order. Anyway, he always aspired to be an actor, but never got a chance. My elder brother, who was brilliant, got the best actor award in school thrice.
Oh, that's so sad.
So that really, Nasir hated it. And he hated school of the torment he was subjected to. But I enjoyed my schooling, he didn't.
So you have this interesting chapter in your book about living in the shadow of a celebrated celebrity brother. What has that experience been like? You know, of course, that's a tongue-in-cheek kind of title for that chapter. But right. Very honestly, sir, was there kind of sibling rivalry? Was it really difficult to be his brother? Because in the beginning, he found it very difficult to be the brother of such accomplished men like you all.
Right. No, I've written a chapter in my book also called Living Under Celebrity Brother's Shadow. And let me admit that I lived under it. I mean, he's the best actor in the country, and I'm not the best soldier of the country. So I acknowledge that. I acknowledge that he's the best actor in the country, and nobody can deny it.
Well, sir, to be deputy chief of the army, you better have been amongst the best soldiers in the country.
That's for you to judge, but I can't claim that. Anyway, when I was made deputy chief, the headlines, even the Times of India, screamed, Nasir Uddin Shah's brother appointed deputy chief. But I laughed it off. And I wrote an article in a paper, Living Under the Shadows, and I gave the 10 questions I've always asked. The last question is he your real brother? And I said, no, artificial, if there can be one. And he can be artificial when he wants to be. Nasir is a chameleon. He can change his appearance, change his almost his character to fit into the role that is demanded of him. And that is why I have no problem of living under his shadow.
So, you know, let's start with the 1971 war, because that really is one of the most epic milestones in the country and in its self-perception also. So, you know, you fought at the Battle of Longewala. What was the most difficult thing about being in that on that battlefront? And, you know, also what is your sort of strongest memory of it? And I'll come back to some of the other questions that you've spoken about General Manekshaw and others. But at first, the battle, you know, what was most difficult about being on that battlefront?
Well, as I said, I was commissioned into a camel regiment. It used to take us 7 days from Bikaner, where we were stabled, up to our operational area, that's in Jaisalmer. So calling off, thinking of cold starts, 7 days. Cold start means within 12 hours you should be ready. But fortunately for us, my commanding general was General Jacob. And he challenged me. He says, you are so fond of your camels, you choose one sand dune where a vehicle fitted with sand tires cannot go. So I selected a Dhora, that's a huge sand dune. And at the appointed time, General Jacob appeared with his ADC and negotiated that dune. And that was the end of the camels. We were asked to give them to the BSF just before the war, and I'm glad that we did. Anyway, we had concentrated around August, September of 1971. There was a lot of talk whether there's going to be war, not no war. We were getting baked in the desert. And end of November, we were summoned that you have to hear an address from General Sam Manekshaw, the chief. So there were several hundreds of us sitting under a camouflage net, waiting for the chief. There was a table covered with an army blanket and a microphone and a chair. We heard his helicopter landing. General Manekshaw, general that time, stormed in, brushed aside the chair, climbed on top of the table, stood with his hands on his hips, and gave us a 2 minute talk. He says, boys, I'm sending you across. So no doubts were left in our minds as to what's going to happen. He says, I want to give you some piece of advice. Firstly, ensure victory. Second, prisoners of war will not be ill-treated. They are serving their country just like you are serving your country. Third, he says, there'll be no booty taking or plunder. And fourth, he says, which is very important, keep away from the begums. I really don't know if he ever kept away. But this was the advice he gave us just before the war. He jumped off the table, had a cup of tea with us, and flew off in a helicopter. He had speaking assignments to in all the divisions. So that really affected us. It raised our morale. Because here was a man with charisma. This is something you can't fake. Sam Manekshaw had charisma. He could motivate. He could, put the fire into bellies in anybody he spoke. Anyway, we got ready, and the D-Day, that means the day we were to cross Pakistan, that means 4th of December night, the Pakistanis took us by surprise. We were at a place called Thanot, and our eastern flank was guarded by a battalion with a company in Longewala under Major Chandpuri, and a battalion at Sadewala under Colonel Khurshid Hussain. Don't believe what Border says. Border is a rubbish movie. It depicts the army in a wrong light, and it specially painted Colonel Khurshid Hussain in a very bad and, well, negative light, which the army represented. Why are you painting an officer who was basically a Muslim, who did his duty for his country? Why are you painting in an ambivalent light? Anyway, but Bollywood does that. It paints every crook, every thug is either Abdul or Kareem. You've seen it. So, you know, the Bollywood is a great opinion builder. And when it paints the Indian Muslims or any Muslim as thugs, smugglers, wife beaters, it conveys a very, very wrong message to the Indian population. So the Pakistanis came in on third night. My battery was deployed in support of Longewala. And we were surrounded by tanks. It was 22 cavalry of the Pakistani army. Modern Chinese T-59 tanks. Our own tanks of antiquated AMX-13 would have been blown to bits by the Pakistani armor because they had only a 75-millimeter gun. The Pakistanis had tanks with a 100-millimeter gun. They kept firing at us the whole night, but for some reason, they did not overrun the post. They were inhibited by a wire fence which we had put to keep dogs and cattle out. They felt it was a minefield, and they made the cardinal blunder. I don't know. Of course, the GOC of the Pakistani division got sacked. The army, the armor overshot the infantry. They left them behind. So what was surrounding us at Longewala was only armor. And we were firing at them with our anti-tank weapons. Anyway, next morning, we called in the Air Force. The hunters came and destroyed that complete regiment. And that was the end of the Pakistanis' thrust.
So, sorry, yes. Were you going to finish making it?
Just. So then after that, the Pakistan army had been defeated. We went into Pakistan, sat there for another 6 months. The biggest enemy was scorpions and snakes and mosquitoes, but not the Pakistanis.
So there's a very interesting detail in your book that I've been dying to ask you about. You said that when you were there on that battlefront, you were rationed just one bottle of water a day, and it was extremely hot, 50 degrees, and you all were, you know, like you said, waiting it out there. And you said to preserve your, and to, you know, to not feel as thirsty as you might otherwise feel, you and other soldiers grew a stubble. How does growing a stubble stop you from being thirsty? This is a strategy that men, I'm sure, would love to have.
Right. Okay. So you were given a bottle of water and a packet of shakarparas for about 10, 12 days. And you could either bathe with that water or drink it. So I decided I'll grow a stubble and not waste water on shaving. I prefer to drink it. And a large number of us did. So that's how. I mean, it was rash. The main problem in the desert was logistic. Not the enemy. You could not traverse the bad patches of sand. You had a shortage of water and food. One of the interesting things that in one of the nights, I think 5th or 6th December, three khaki-clad figures entered my gun position with the hands up. So luckily, the sentry didn't fire. Oh, they said, you know, don't shoot. Hum Bengali officer hain. They were actually Pakistani deserters, some Bengali officers who had deserted the Pakistan army, found their way into the gun position. Anyway, we deprived them of their weapons. send them back, and they fought the rest of the war of the Mukti Bahini. So this was the experience of 1971. The troops didn't bother who I was. They had full faith, they had confidence, and it really, I told you, that religion is secondary business in the army. One doesn't bother about it. What is interesting is what happened in the East. General Jacob, in his book, has written about it. I would say that the aim in Bangladesh was salami slicing. We never intended to capture Dhaka. We just intended to salami slicing of Bangladesh and declare it as an independent country, but that wouldn't have succeeded. I would say it was only General Jacob who persuaded General Sam Manekshaw, who was about to give in to the demands of the political leadership, to go into Bangladesh in June 1971. That would have been a folly. That would have been a big blunder. Because then the passes in Sikkim and Nifa were open. It would have been easy for the Chinese to intervene. The rivers in Bangladesh were in spate. So General Sam Manekshaw listened to the words of General Jacob and his briefing to Mrs. Indira Gandhi in April 1971. He read out the recommendations of General Jacob, which says, let's not go until November. Srimati Indira Gandhi conceded to the request of Sam Manekshaw. In the book, Sam Manekshaw has joked about, don't interfere, I've got a long nose and you've got a long nose. That is all in humor. Actually, the decision was taken in the operational room of the Army headquarters. What I'm trying to stress is that the Indian Army is subordinate to political authority, but not subservient to political authority. I'll repeat it again. We are subordinate to political authority, but not subservient. That means it is on the strength of how we projected that the political decision to go into Bangladesh was changed. It was delayed from June to December 1971. And this is very, very important for senior generals to remember. We are not subservient. We must not hesitate to put across our point of view and firmly and strongly.
So, sir, you know, oh, we've run out of time really quickly and we've only done 1971. Let's quickly move to, you know, I was going to ask you, but maybe you can speak to General Shah over dinner later. But you said that General Jacobs had a very scathing assessment of General Manekshaw, which you asked him to tone down. But now I don't have time to ask you about that, and maybe, you know, the audience can ask you about it later over dinner. Let's just move to Gujarat 2002, because it would be unfair to get off the stage without discussing it. That you were, you know, and here I'll stress your Muslim identity, that you were a Muslim officer that was called in to quell the Gujarat riots, you know, which was really a very communal riot in 2002. What was your experience there, sir? And you've made some extremely forthright and strong statements now in your book, which were really things that the administration, political administration under Mr. Modi, were accused of in 2002. But you kept quiet all these years. But first, very quickly, if you can share your experience of what really happened, and then why did you stay quiet all these years?
Well, first thing I'd like to tell you is that I've made no political comments. I've made no political accusations. That's not my job. I've only highlighted the mistakes. And in my walk the talk with Mr. Shekhar, I said it was an administrative failure. Anyway, we were deployed in Rajasthan again. I was commanding a division of the strike corps meant for an offensive into Pakistan. We were in depth at a place called Agulai and Jodhpur. The holding, that means Gujarat had been denuded of troops. All were of the holding formation and were holding the border in Rajasthan. So when the riots happened on 27th of February, because permission was given to burn, to bring the dead bodies of the burnt Karsevaks in a procession to Ahmedabad. That was blunder number one. I think Because of that, it inflamed passions. And there was resulting riots all over Gujarat. I had attended an exercise and was sitting in my tent when I get a call directly from the chief, General Padmanabhan. A chief generally doesn't address a division commander. You've got a chain of command. The chief, the command headquarters, the corps headquarters, and then the division. Anyway, he spoke to me. He says, Zoom, that is the army name I bear. He says, get maximum troops into Ahmedabad and quell the riots. This was the terse orders he gave me. I said, sir, it'll take me 2 days to reach Ahmedabad from Agulai. He says, don't worry. The Air Force is taking responsibility for that, and get your troops onto Jodhpur airfield. So I left immediately. As soon as I received the orders, along with my ADC and my communications, I reached Jodhpur airfield. The aircraft were flying in. Aircraft, and I embarked on the first aircraft. This was on the midnight of 28th of February. I had been assured by the chief that on landing, we would get the transport, we would get the radio sets, we would get the police guides, the magistrates, all the paraphernalia which is required for aid to civil administration. Anyway, we flew in into Ahmedabad airfield. From the air, I could see the whole town aflame. There were fires burning all over the town. We landed on a dark and deserted airfield, and nobody from the civil administration met me, except one brigadier who was deputy GOC of the holding formation. So I got off the aircraft with my vehicle, and I asked him, where's the civil administration? Where are the vehicles? He shrugged his shoulders and says, the civil administration will give you that. So I says, where's the chief secretary? Oh, he says he's gone abroad. Who's officiating? He gave me a number. I tried to dial. It was around midnight of 28th. No response. So I decided that the best thing to do was to go to the chief minister's residence. I got a guide and reached his residence at 2 a.m. on 1st of March. He was having, there to my great and relief, was Mr. George Fernandez, the Raksha Mantri. So I had a slight meal with, I partook of what they were eating. It was either a late dinner or an early breakfast, I don't know what it was. But I told the chief minister, I said, sir, where's the transport? Where are the magistrates? The radio sets, we were to get mobiles because our sets are high frequency, they don't work in high-rise buildings. He says, sab mil jayega, General Saab. Maine kaha, humare paas to nakshe bhi nahi hai. So I had carried a tourist map, and on the tourist map, I plotted all the trouble spots. I again impressed that logistic support is essential. And I told him that by 7 o'clock in the morning, we'll have about 3,000 troops at the airfield. He says, sab mil jayega. I went back to the airfield, but the whole day we waited and nothing came. Mr. George Fernandez visited us on 1st of March at about 10 o'clock, and I made the same complaint. While going to Modi Nagar, I found rioting terrible. I found minority pockets surrounded. So I asked the police, why haven't you enforced curfew? They says, humne kar rakha hai, magar maan nahi koi ra. Nobody. They were not prepared to enforce curfew in majority areas. And I found that the minority ghettos had been surrounded and the police firing into the windows of minority homes. So I said, what are you doing? They said, we are keeping the mobs at bay. Then I said, turn your rifles the other direction. Why are you firing into the homes? So the police was partial. They were totally communalized and not doing their job at all. Anyway, we waited. Next morning, that means 2nd of March 2002, the vehicles, our vehicle columns, plus the trailers which the civil administration had collected, came in, and we went into Ahmedabad. And I'm proud to say that what 108 companies of paramilitary and police could not do, the army did within 48 hours. We quelled the riots. We quelled the riots. There was no quarter given to any arsonist. We shot up about 20-odd people that night. All 2 dead, 18 wounded, because we had given strict orders firing was to be below the belt. So the army, the soldiers didn't bother. A funny question was asked to me, why all the casualties were of the majority community. Well, I says, a soldier doesn't recognize who's a minority, who's a majority. They only recognize an arsonist. And they've killed and shot at arsonists. So don't ask me as to the communal breakup of the casualties. And the troops really did a magnificent job. And we sorted out the riots. And so that's how the army works.
So, sir, I'm really sorry, but we've run out of time. And like I said, that you have now very forthrightly, and you gave this action taken report to General Padmanabhan after the riots were quelled and you went back. And then you were serving in the Northeast. But very specifically, you've said that the army was there in Gujarat on the night of 28th. 3,000 troops had been airlifted with 60 flights. You said that the police was partisan. You said that the police hierarchy was extremely communalized. And in fact, you told Mr. Fernandez that the police hierarchy needed to be changed. And he said, you took the words out of my mouth, but nothing happened. And then that you found that the police either melted away, they did not enforce the curfew, or that they were shooting directly into minority homes. Now, all of these are some of the direct accusations that were put on Mr. Modi's doorstep as being a kind of administrative failure allowing the riots to happen. This was a very big, and coming from the horse's mouth, it was big evidence. But 3 commissions of inquiry were set up, and you did not speak. And you are now speaking so many years later, sir, when perhaps the impact of it is not so strong. Why did you stay silent all these years? We'll have to end on that note.
Well, people feel that the book of mine is my platform for a jump into politics, which it is not. Ladies and gentlemen, after I finished with Gujarat, I was moved into the Northeast again into sorting out insurgencies. And I didn't even know about these commissions. Nobody asked me. The first time I read, when after I gave this statement, the press told me that, General, the accusation that you are lying in the book, because the SIT report says that you were given logistic support on the night of 28th of February. I said, why didn't the SIT consult me? They never consulted me. I didn't even know what report they had given. And I said, and I repeat again, the SIT report was a blatant lie. I'll repeat, the SIT report was a blatant lie and a cover-up. And the truth should have been taken from the written report which I gave, or I should have been questioned by the SIT. It was not my job to go and tell them that I want to make a statement. Why did I write the book 12 years later? I didn't get chance to breathe. After I finished, retired from the army in 2008, I was for 3 years a judge in the Armed Forces Tribunal. And then I, from the frying pan into the fire, I went to Aligarh Muslim University as its vice chancellor. It was the most challenging period of my life. After that, I got 1 year and I wrote the book. So there was no, well thought after plan of action. It's just that I got a free year and I wrote the book.
Thank you for doing that, sir. And as you said, that you've been so forthright about your experience in the army that the question actually is, and is probably for everyone else to ask, why would 3 commissions of inquiry not speak to the general that quelled the riots? Why would the SIT not summon the general that quelled the riots to at least give evidence? Again, it's important that General Padmanabhan has backed every word that you've said. And you said these were contemporaneous war diaries and they can't be fudged. The fact that none of these make up part of the commission reports are something which are very troubling for our democracy, because these are really issues of democracy itself. So it's important that you've written it now, sir, if not earlier. Unfortunately, we don't have time to get into the big battlefront where you took on your own community in Aligarh Muslim University and brought the kind of army discipline that you had been taught into a university that was beginning to lose its ethos. But as I said, you know, I'm glad we're having dinner, and maybe that'll be part of the dinner conversation that follows. But thank you very, very much, sir, for your experiences and for your forthrightness.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.